And thank goodness, Dick Hill took me aside and he said, you know, I don't think this is really a good idea. He said, this is what's going to happen. You're going to go to Sun Valley and you're going to meet some ski instructor named Sven. And you're going to end up 5 years later living in Ketchum, Idaho, with laundry out on the back line and two little kids running around wondering whatever happened to your dreams. And so he said, don't go be a ski bum. He said, here is an application for a National Science Foundation graduate fellowship. You apply and you will get one. Here are applications to graduate school. You apply, you will get in. He said, do it now, I'm waiting. And I did, and it happened. And I went to Scripps on an NSF fellowship, and I didn't get derailed from my dreams. And that is what a good mentor does for you. And at that time, there was no Women's Aquatic Network to give me that kind of advice. But there were good mentors that made sure that they knew what your dreams were, and they knew how easily you could get derailed if you didn't immediately pursue your dreams. So I went on to Scripps, and I got there, and they didn't know what to do with me. They said, well, you know, we had to look up Colorado College on the map because we had never heard of it. And we weren't really quite sure of their standards, but gosh, we had to accept you because of your GRE scores. We couldn't say no. But now that you're here, well, we'll see how you do. And I was kind of like their pet rock, you know? They absolutely didn't know what to make of me. So, because women were just like a rarity there, my advisor was a little bit concerned that I might not survive. And he said to me, frankly, he said, you look like a surfer chick that just walked off the beach. And he said, I don't think people are going to take you seriously. So the first year, what he did was he sent me to Navy SEAL Team School. And I spent the first 3 months on Coronado Island with the Navy SEAL teams, learning my marks and mods for explosives training, because Scripps needed a number of their personnel who were trained in underwater demolitions. Because at that time, all of the marine seismic refraction was still done with explosives. So I came back from my 3 months at Navy SEAL Team School, and I had actually graduated first in the class. And the way I had done that was actually that it turns out that SEAL Team School is not all about brawn. It is all about precision. So for example, for the final exam in the class, I mean, you know, obviously the written part I had aced because I was a PhD student, you know, so like obviously if I can't ace the written part, you know, I don't have any right to be in a PhD program. But for the practical part, which was the field training, the instructor would take us out, you know, into the water and into the field, and he would ask you to get something done with dead cord and with PTEX and other explosives. And the important thing was you had to exactly get it done. If you blew everything to smithereens, you failed. If you didn't get it done, you failed. And so in this one part of the practical exam, there was a armored troop carrier, and the instructor said to me, I want you to make a hole in the door of this troop carrier such that I can get my fist through it. So I took some C4 explosive and I made a shape charge that blew a hole in the side of the door. But all the instructors at that time, they were all smokers. They all smoked cigarettes. So I blew a piece out of the door that blew it into the shape of an ashtray that etched into the bottom of the ashtray a picture of a seal with the date in the bottom of it. So when the piece came out, he had a little souvenir from the class with the seal and the date. And I handed it to him and I said, here you go, officer. And so that's how I just It's all about precision, not about wrong. So after I got back to Scripps after that, of course, word went around about the seal thing, and no one messed with me. And you know, I hear all these Me Too stories and stuff like that about sexual harassment, and people ask me, well, did you ever have problems with sexual harassment when you were a student and a postdoc? And I said, no one ever messed with me. Ever would do that. And I think, you know, when they know that you know how to take care of them in a way that nobody's even that people don't even try. So that was a very, I think, important thing. And I credit my advisor with thinking ahead on that. Now, let me just go on to, I just got back from the AGU meeting.